Okay, we'll get going here tonight. I got everybody on lecture mode, and I've got the call on record for to let's announce the date, January 24th, Monday evening. This call is being pre-recorded. This is the Dinar update call with the BH Group. My name is Charlie Emmenecker, the call moderator, and my friend Brad Huebner is the leader of the BH Group. Brad's the gentleman that decided to put many thumbprints on people's lives once he knew what he had his hands on with the Iraqi Dinar and the opportunity. Brad's owned Dinar for quite some time, and Brad and I are both seasoned veteran network marketers who understands the power of the word, of the truth, the facts, not opinions, but of facts. And when Brad shared with me the information that he's going to share with you this past summer, I thought about it and thought about it. I said, Brad, I got to share this with a few of my friends that are in my world and in my life and also associated with me in our lifelong business with Zango. And one thing's led to another, and one call started at 200, 500, 1,000, 1,200, and then we sent it to a few more people and jumped to 5,500 people on the call. That's why we've had to pre-record this call. And in a minute or so, Brad's going to kick into the Dinar 101, the latest info as to where we are at. We suggest, and he will ask you, if you are experienced even in Dinar, that you perhaps want to listen to this to reassure yourself. Yes, this has drug on. I was going to call this the Dinar Intel No-Tell call for this evening because there's so much scuttlebutt going around out there. And I think we're going to be able to put people at ease. I do believe that we'll give you the information that is necessary. And as Brad mentioned on the pre-call here, we expect to have Rudy Coenen, the international currency expert. Rudy's had a couple setbacks with his health lately, so we'll just ask everybody to put Rudy in his prayers. It's not life-threatening, but he's got to be careful. So without further ado, my friend Brad, by the way, you were honored amongst our peers and friends in Laguna Beach. We won't go into that anymore, but we sure want this thing to end in the Dinar world so we can get on with the rest of our business career. So, Brad, my friend, we would like you to have you come to the front of the class, so to speak. And we have some newbies. I have some of my good friends in our other business on the call for the very first time tonight, Brad, who maybe you met them today on the phone. So I'd like to have you do your best on Dinar 101.
Thanks, Charlie. And there are hundreds of newbies that will be on the call not only tonight but throughout the week as our friends pass this link along to their friends and family. So tonight I think it would be very beneficial even for those veteran Dinaritarians who have been on what we call the Dinar roller coaster and have started to question the validity of their investment to take the time and listen carefully once again to my updated Dinar 101 to refresh your brain on the virtues of why you made an investment in the Dinar in the first place. It just might have a very calming effect for you. Now, this call is intended to educate potential prospects we call newbies that want to learn the truth behind what will be the largest single financial event of our time, and that is the pending revaluation of the Iraqi Dinar, which is the currency of Iraq. The ramifications of this event will change world history, politics, and even religion in their region. This ongoing history lesson will be presented so that you can make an intelligent decision on how you can participate financially at whatever safe level you feel comfortable. This is not a social or religious network, but strictly an opportunity to invest by purchasing the Iraqi Dinar at an extremely discounted rate before the pending revaluation. The BH Group is here to help you procure your dinars, receive them in a punctual manner, and then guide and support you through the pre- and post-revaluation process to the best of our ability. You'll benefit greatly from my relationship with Ali of Dinar Trade, the undisputed number one dinar dealer with contracts with the Central Bank of Iraq. We've worked together to provide an exchange center to be located in Toledo, Ohio, that'll be set up when the revaluation occurs to give you the best conversion and exchange rates in a very timely manner. Now, here's the key point. Because of this relationship, I'll be called directly by Ali when the RV happens. He'll probably know 2 hours or so before anybody else in the United States, most likely in the still of the night. Then I'll immediately send all BH group members an email. We're even working on a text system with implicit instructions to set their appointment or, if necessary, lock in their rate to maximize their investment. This timing can mean a huge difference in your investment. This history lesson is what's known as the plan, the most brilliant example of international finance based on fossil fuels, currency, and politics the world has ever seen. And it was orchestrated primarily by former Vice President Dick Cheney, who at one time was chairman of Halliburton, the leading oil services company in the world, and key members of the Federal Reserve. Now, for those of you that don't know, the Fed is its own corporation and guided and managed on its own. The U.S. Congress has no say in its internal or external policies. The Fed is an independent organization that helps maintain economic stability in the world. Now, by the end of this call, you'll fully understand what the Fed and the U.S. government have been doing behind the scenes for the last decade in Iraq, and what's about to come to fruition for the United States as the leader of the coalition forces that freed Iraq from the tyranny of Saddam Hussein. You'll recall Iraq under Saddam went on a rampage in the early 90s and invaded his neighbor Kuwait, where they literally raped, pillaged, and then burned the oil wells on the way out as the U.S. chased him back to Iraq under President Bush Sr. The United Nations then severely punished Iraq by putting economic sanctions on the country that helped devastate their economy, driving their currency, the dinar, from a high value of $3.22 per dinar to its current low value of little more than a tenth of a penny. Now, this is what I call the ultimate paradox, where you have the richest country in the world with a currency that is basically worthless. Because of Saddam's actions in Kuwait and the brutality he was showing against the Kurds in northern Iraq, the U.S. was forced to make a political, military, and humanitarian move to extricate him from power. Those were the altruistic reasons that were given by our government, but the real reasons were to protect our supply of oil and make huge profits, as we're currently economic and political hostages addicted to oil. This is where Cheney, Bush, and the leaders of the Fed came up with the plan, this brilliant strategy, as you'll learn, involving oil, currency, and politics, that was a way for us to get back into Iraq and protect oil interests, create trillions of dollars of profits, and as a sidebar, try to have the Iraqi government become a democracy in the middle of the very important Middle East and bring political stability to that region without seeming to be American imperialists. Now, Cheney created a tremendous amount of fear that there was a possibility Saddam had weapons of mass destruction and that the U.S. had to get back into Iraq quickly with military force and put an end to his regime. The U.S. took this plan to the United Nations and got approval for an invasion into Iraq to stop this maniacal leader. The next thing you saw was on CNN with bombs bursting over Baghdad while the U.S. invaded Iraq. Within 48 to 72 hours, we had control of the country and had chased the Iraqi army and Saddam underground. The rest is history, as Hollywood even showed you on its rendition of the plan in the recent movie The Green Zone, starring Matt Damon. And one of our members told me that it's the HBO movie of the week, so you might want to check it out. You see, they never did find any weapons of mass destruction when the U.S. got back into Iraq, but we started spreading the seeds of democracy in a country that goes back centuries in the Bible, known as Babylon, and is the origin of the Garden of Eden. This country has always been violently split by three religious tribes, the Shiites, the largest of the three, the Sunnis, and Kurds, that have never been able to get along. However, within 2 short years, the first democratic election was held under U.S. supervision, and 83% of these tribes finally agreed on one thing, and that was freedom. They all risked their lives by sticking their index finger in an inkwell, marking themselves as a voter. Now think of the magnitude of that statement and the ridiculously low levels we have going to our polls after we've sacrificed hundreds and thousands of lives for freedom. Now, over 9 months ago on March 7th, Iraq held its second election, this time without much U.S. intervention. And once again, over 80% of the people voted, showing their real thirst for freedom. After earning the unprofound distinction of being the longest interim government in history, the parliament is now in full session and finally named Nouriel Maliki, former prime minister, as the new PM after he had lost the popular vote back in March to his Sunni competitor, Alawi. In the true spirit of a coalition government, Alawi accepted the powerful position of president of the newly formed National Council. Now, all three presidents will report to this position, therefore reducing Maliki's power significantly from what he had had in the last regime. Alawi will also have a veto power over any of Maliki's proposals, which is a huge compromise and probably the reason Kurds went along with keeping Maliki in the now somewhat figurehead prime minister position. Maliki is in the finishing stages of naming and submitting all of his cabinet positions, but there are still two cabinet positions to go. Also this week, there are a lot of rumblings calling for Maliki's head as he's up to some of his old tricks of trying to gain an edge over these other two tribes. Now, it took 9 months of political persuasion to form the government, which was an absolute prerequisite before a revaluation of the currency could become a reality. The other huge recent news that you need to know about is the United Nations Security Council lifted the Chapter 7 that Iraq had been under for many years that will now allow them to have commerce with the outside world. Ladies and gentlemen, this is major progress that we are seeing week by week as we live this whole experience. The budget is now in place for the final process for approval. However, the missing major factor is the rate. In my opinion, the rate has been decided on the intrinsic values of their natural resources and the amount of dinar in circulation. It also has been approved by the CBI, the International Monetary Fund, and the Fed. So now it's a matter of getting all of the talking heads together to decide when to pull the trigger. All you really need to know is that the RV is imminent. It literally could happen in the next few days or in the next month or two, but it will happen, and when it happens, it'll affect all four corners of the world because of the magnitude of this event. There's much intel that comes out of Iraq on a daily basis, some based on true facts and much on pure smoke. But there is no way that the pending revaluation can be kept quiet, as there's just too much coordination and things to accomplish on multiple fronts before the blessing becomes a reality. However, one thing for sure is that a democratic Iraq with economic sanctions relieved can start constructing the infrastructure of the next international economic superpower. As the world's fastest emerging economy gets rolling, it'll help put an end to the worldwide recession. Consider this. There are over 4,000 contracts already in place, from billions of dollars to millions of dollars, ready to start. And I don't think they'll be paid with a dinar valued at a tenth of a penny. Now, back in December of 2009, Iraq invited the top oil companies of the world to come in and bid on the oil drilling rights. Long story short, Iraq received hundreds of millions just from the bid process, and then the oil companies were awarded contracts by bidding a low of $1.15 a barrel to a high of $4 a barrel for the rights to drill in certain areas throughout Iraq. This means, at the current price of roughly $90 a barrel, Iraq will receive $86 to $88.85 per barrel, while the oil companies will put in the infrastructure, drill the wells, and put the transmission pipelines in the place to the ports. Iraq will benefit greatly as the price of oil escalates going forward, as many countries currently holding dinars will become customers for decades. Remember, $90 to $95 a barrel going forward, and they're sitting on an ocean of oil, and it's only going to cost them about $1.15 to $4 per barrel to extricate the oil and get it sold. Now, it's important to understand who controls the outstanding Iraqi dinars, which some estimate at roughly $26 trillion. Actually, various countries, including the United States, United Kingdom, China, Russia, etc., and central banks around the world, control approximately 55% of the total dinars, with the U.S. estimated to have $3.7 trillion in their coffers. Iraq has 42% of the outstanding for their own internal economy, while only about 3% of the outstanding dinars are in the hands of speculators like ourselves. There is much at stake here with oil and the dinar, and that is the value of the U.S. dollar, and I might add the very weak euro. The Fed controls the central banks around the world and is not about to give up control of the dollar, and the dinar is their vehicle to accomplish this. If you look at other countries in the Gulf, they all have thriving economies based on their oil production that has allowed them to construct magnificent architectural oases in the middle of deserts. Only Iraq and Iran have been stuck in the Stone Age primarily because of the religious and political differences that have paralyzed them. The Fed and the U.S. government already know that Iran will self-destruct as Iraq becomes an economic powerhouse. Just the development of Iraq's basic infrastructure is enough commercial activity to give the world the economic shot of penicillin to lead us out of a recession and strengthen the U.S. dollar. The Fed will not let the euro or any other currency harm the dollar. And just imagine the economic boost from individuals that will start spending their newfound wealth. Now, we investors have been patiently waiting for the RV of the Iraqi dinar. Kuwait had their own revaluation back in the early 90s when the dinar went from 10 cents to over $3.30 per dinar. Now, listen closely. Just 2 months ago, the Kuwaiti dinar had another revaluation out of the clear blue as it revalued up to $3.58 from $3.30. This could be a major hint on the pending rate of the Iraqi dinar, as Kuwait has always said they did not want the Iraqi dinar to be one penny higher than theirs. I've been holding dinars personally for almost 6.5 years, and last year I decided to start telling my friends and family about the knowledge I'd learned, because if I hadn't, it would have been a very selfish act. Since then, I've been on a mission to educate as many people as I can before the RV, and my team has accomplished a lot. When the blessing happens, this will be my true goal, as I'll have been part of leaving a thumbprint on tens of thousands of families, helping them possibly for generations. I'd now like to put a challenge out to all of you on the call this evening, especially as we come down the final stretch, to make your effort to leave your right and left thumbprint on two new people that you care deeply about this week, so that you'll understand the joy it is to help change a person's life. Imagine, we'll get this call out to well over 10,000 people during the week, and that would mean an additional 20,000 people would experience the blessing before it's too late because of your thoughtfulness. Just forward them this link. Please do the right thing. I've been fortunate to network right into the vortex of several major lines of intel coming in from all over the world, which is very helpful for you as you learn the ropes. Anyone can buy dinar on the internet, but you'll be left like an island in the ocean without a life jacket. You need to be guided in taking your next very important steps so that you don't make costly mistakes during the entire pre- and post-RV exchange process. You'll be assured of getting the best rates in a timely manner, as well as being guided to professional financial people post-RV. Buying dinar without a lifeline is a very scary thought. Just ask anyone who has done this, and they'll tell you how valuable our services have been. The BH Group is strictly about people helping people, both now and after the RV, in a professional business environment with information that can help save you a fortune. those of you that want to purchase dinars and receive key intel, email me at brad@thebhgroup.org. My assistant, Kelly, will get you all the information as soon as possible. Our phone number is 419-740-5220. Now, before we move to the next step of the call, there is some housekeeping we need to talk about. The price and availability of dinar has been very volatile lately, but there has been some stability shown since January 11th, as the Central Bank of Iraq placed a large amount at auction late last week after receiving new supplies of currency from Delarue in England. Please understand, the BH Group is a competitive supplier of dinars. We ship the same day as we receive your cashier's check. We are in the process of having a website available for your convenience featuring all of our services. We will have an extensive frequently asked questions section that will be a great reference for you regarding all aspects of the dinar. Once again, for those of you scouring the dinar sites on the internet for valuable information, quote unquote, that is going to reveal something that is going to give you a clue to the date and rate. You can save yourself a lot of frustration, but do your proper homework that you've done before you made your investment, and now it's time to just let it go and get back to your life. The revaluation will happen in its own time frame, as it's a macroeconomic event that has tremendous consequences that will affect the entire world. I believe a lot of the anxiety that many dinar holders have is due to sheer desperation. We all have been through tremendously tough economic times for the last 3+ years, and the scars are deep and they're everywhere. And the dinar has allowed people to dream once again and have hope, and this fuels their anxiety. However, this investment is real, but you have to be patient and let it unfold in its own time frame to the world. Remember, I will get the call personally from Ali, who is the only person I would trust to have the real intelligence when the RV happens. And you will have an email from me within 30 minutes of that call, which will probably happen in the still of the night anyway. This is really all you have to know, so please just chill and have patience. Now that we've done our best to help educate the newbies, it's time to reward all of you veteran dinaritarians with a real treat. Our guest speaker this evening is our good friend Rudolph Coenen, backed by popular demand. For those of you that don't know Rudy, he worked with J.P. Morgan for 15 years at a very high level in their currency department and has been involved with the dinar for several years. Rudy is calling in tonight from his hospital bed in Florida. And, Rudy, we do appreciate all you do for the BH Group and know that all our prayers are with you for speedy recovery, my friend. So welcome to our call.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Brad, Charlie, and everybody on the line there.
Hey, Rudy, thank you.
Yeah, I want to just let you guys know I'm doing well. I'm back in the hospital under very good care with my doctors here at a very good hospital, St. Luke's Hospital here in Jacksonville, Florida. I'm doing fine. I appreciate everybody's prayers and concerns. And I'm sorry I couldn't be with you guys last week. I had to attend to, you know, my physical needs. But I'm here to try to enlighten and bring some peace to this roller coaster of a ride that we're on.
Well, Rudy, you know, this week has been very volatile. You know, the rumors just keep increasing at an increasing rate. And why don't you just give us a little enlightenment as to your take on the last week and where we're headed this week?
You know, the last week has been really one that I'd never seen so much rumor at such an unprecedented level. You know, we were hearing about, you know, countries in the Middle East having their own internal RBs with the dinar, and banks were cashing in on them, and nothing was substantiated. Nothing that I've ever heard from anybody on any one of these rumor mills was it substantiated. But it drove a lot of a lot of frenzy throughout the Dinar community. And I can understand that, but I want people to realize that currencies and countries do not revalue their currencies in that manner. They don't give a preferential position to any country in particular. That's discriminatory, and the IMF is totally against that. So you need to sit back and reason about what you're reading and what you're looking at. You know, when you see that there's a rumor coming out that it RV'd last night in Abu Dhabi, or it RV'd in Jordan, and people are running to the bank to cash in, why would that occur in Jordan and not happen in Iraq, the country that the currency belongs to? So, you know, everybody here has to kind of become, has to really take 10 deep breaths and then realize that what you're reading is just, there are people that on purpose will make up rumors just to have their name and their story be read on the internet. They get a hell of a satisfaction to know that they're driving people crazy. And so I want all of you investors, and I'm not calling you, I want you to look at yourself as investors. All of you investors need to think like an investor and say, wait, this does not make any sense. You know, the currency in Iraq, they are the ones who are going to release that revalue or reinstatement, and it'll come from Iraq, and then it'll spread throughout the global currency community. But this week has been one of a lot of rumors. You know, I, for one, have said in the past that it had to have a seat, and there are some positions that haven't been met yet, haven't been filled yet. We're starting to see a lot of insurgency attacks in Iraq. One of the reasons that we're seeing that is because they're trying to take advantage and destabilize the country. You know, just yesterday we had 10 people that were killed in a couple of bombings that happened throughout Baghdad. And we're probably going to see more of this if Maliki doesn't come up with the people necessary to fill those positions and meet all of the three tribes' needs. So, you know, do we see an army coming tomorrow, Thursday, this Sunday? I believe not. I still think we're probably going to look closer to the middle of February, if not the beginning of February. But he has to make that move now. And is the IMF... are they desperate for Iraq to do this? Yes, they are. You know, in Politico, in a newspaper today called Politico, the IMF made a comment that Iraq was not meeting its financial needs on an international level. So that was just kind of like a jab in the ribs. Hey, you got to come out with your currency, and you got to start playing ball. So, you know, there's a lot of things going on out there, a lot of things.
Brad and Rudy, this is our call. We're not intel specialists per se. Don't want to be. We don't post anything on any websites. Rudy's the only guy that I think is qualified to post anything. Not me, not Brad. But it appears as though 99% of all the requirements for all the sanctions to be lifted are done, so that this country can go back into business. But it seems as though there is one major sticking position. And it looks like it's Mr. Maliki, who is trying to pull some punches or pull some things behind the scenes. But everybody can see what's going on. Do you have any opinion about that and what he tried to actually get the CBI under the purview of his government? So, what do you guys think about where we're at with Maliki?
Is Don on the call?
No, Don can't make it.
Yeah, well, I think really what's going on here is, you know, Maliki has a power mongers type of characteristic. He tries to rule through power, and he has in his last administration he did that, and he likes to have his cronies surround him. But the problem here is that they're not allowing that. The parliament's not allowing it. The other three parties aren't allowing it. They want people that are going to be transparent and are going to provide for the country. And he has a hard time taking that into essence. It's always been Maliki's problem. It's always been about him, his people, his cronies, and himself. And now that he's being pushed that he has to be transparent, he has to provide the needs of the country, you know, he's having a hard time finding anybody that really wants to work with him, because they don't want to get the stigma that if he doesn't comply with what the people want, then they're burned politically. You see, a lot of these young men that are entering into these political positions don't want to be associated with Maliki because they want to continue their political life in Iraq. They want to be public servants for the next 20 or 30 years. But if you burn yourself in the first 4 years of your administration, you won't get anywhere politically for the rest of your life. So you basically ruin your political career. So there's a lot of people that just don't want to hold these positions. And the ones that do want to hold them want to be embezzlers. They want to embezzle money. They want to be corrupt. So there's a vacuum of intelligent, career-minded public servants who want to do the right thing for the country. And there's a vacuum of the ones that want to work with Maliki. So, you know, he's having a hard time trying to get people in those positions because they don't want to burn their political career. And that's a big problem. You don't read that. You don't see that coming out in the newspapers, but that's a true underlying problem. I was speaking to a friend of mine from the State Department, and, you know, he brought that to my attention. I never even thought about that. I said, you know, I never thought about that. Here's a country that's barely blossoming, and you've got all of these young men that are returning to Iraq. You've got a lot of American Iraqis who are going back to Iraq to try to position themselves in a country that's going to, you know, grow and rebirth, but they don't want to be part of that administration. I think if Alawi would have been the prime minister, this would have already occurred. It would have occurred a month ago. I think you would have had a lot more people joining the party, joining them as public servants, positioning themselves, growing in their political career, and helping the country of Iraq. So Maliki's just got a bad reputation. Yeah.
You know, I think this is really indicative. You know, this fledgling young democracy and these types of problems that, you know, that they have to work through. I mean, this is all part of it. And this is where, you know, the people of Iraq have suffered tremendously. And we as investors should not have the audacity to even think, where's my money when this country and their people are going through traumatic times, have been through traumatic times, and are trying to do the right thing to establish the proper base to be the next international economic superpower of the world.
Yes,
Brad,
yes, definitely.
I agree.
I agree. You know, we've been very egotistical in the way that we view the dinar. A lot of the conversations, a lot of what I read out in the forums, I see a lot of impatience, a lot of frustration, a lot of egomaniacs who are just thinking about me, myself, and I, and don't even take into consideration what the people of Iraq have been through. You know, 5-10 years from now, after this thing is RV'd and we've collected our money and we've done the good work and we've spread, you know, the good news around the earth. We're going to have to sit down one day and think and maybe, you know, reach a hand out and shake someone's hand in Iraq. If I for myself would love to visit that country and thank the people for the opportunity that I'm getting as a U.S. citizen to be able to be part of the birth of their nation. As I've talked to you, Brad, and you, Charlie, you know, right now we're opening up this Iraqi Global Equity Fund, and the SEC is holding the papers right now. We should get approval within the next 3 to 6 weeks. And I think that's my effort. And Charlie, I've talked to you about it. And you, Brad, your efforts of doing our part in growing their economy through our investments. But, yeah, I think we need to be very patient on our investment. We need to kind of sit back and let this work itself out. It's going to take some time. You know, just – what has it been? 4 months since our troops left? 4 to 6 months?
Right. You know, I have something Don Turner just sent me before he had to go to some meeting or whatever. He sent me an email about Joe Biden speaking. I'm going to send this to everybody. It's a C-SPAN video. And he said to me, strongly recommend listening to this, whether you like Joe or not. Put your politics aside for a few minutes and learn. About 10 minutes into it, I believe it is a powerful understanding of what it takes to get this done, et cetera, in Iraq and what is actually going on. So I'm going to attach that, Brad, when I send out the call the replay link for our MP3 file. What I think I'll do is I'll attach that link onto to our call tonight, and they'll kind of maybe help sort things out for people so that along with Brad's website that he's putting up, and Rudy, all of your great information, maybe we can help people boil this down to understand more about what is really going on. This is indeed a macroeconomic event, and what I would like Rudy to do, there's a couple points that keep coming up all the time, and one with one of my friends who used to own his own bank in the Scottsdale area. He stuck some of his money into this, and he said to me when we were out in Laguna Beach here this past weekend, he says, I still don't figure this out. He said, there's one thing I don't understand. Why are people that have the dinar selling it, and why are Ali and et cetera? And he said, when this thing starts to cash in, isn't it going to collapse the banking system? So why don't you kind of touch on the fact that the Forex, a lot of the screens, the Forex, on the Forex, people doing business in the Forex, the IQD is now starting to pop up in pairings, and cover is this type of macro event. Are we going to explode or implode the banking system?
There's always been this misinformation that, if you look at the way currencies are, it's an even exchange. If I've got 1 ounce of gold and it's worth $1,000, and you hand me an ounce of gold and I hand you $1,000, we've just done an even exchange. Neither am I profiting or you're losing, and you're not losing and I'm not profiting. We've done an even exchange. So there's been this misinformation that when this RVs, that Iraq's going to have so much money in their account to be able to cover the exchange of the dinar. Well, it doesn't work like that. If Iraq is the owner of 100 billion dinars and it RVs to $3, now they have 300 billion dinars, dollars, right? And I do an even exchange for dinars and dollars, it's even. I don't have to cover anything because the moment you hand me my dinar, it's still worth a dollar. And the moment I hand you an American dollar, it's worth a dollar. It's an even exchange. There's been this misinformation that they've got to have so much amount of money in their bank account to be able to cover the exchange. It doesn't work like that. When you have a managed float, if they come out with a managed float, it's going to be a certain price for the next 90 or 60 days or 180 days, and that's what it's going to be worth. So if I hand you $3 and you hand me one dinar, guess what? I'm holding in reality $3 in my hand, even though it's one dinar. You may be holding three American dollars, but those three American dollars can still buy that one dinar that's in my hand. It's a straight even exchange. There's no certain amount of money that needs to be in the account to be able to cover it because we've given it a value. And if the IMF approves the value and the World Bank approves the value, then we're it's like if we said, well, gold's now worth $2,000. Now, whoever had it in their hand and sold it yesterday at $1,000, well, yeah, he took a loss. But did he truly take a loss today? No, he didn't because he exchanged it yesterday. He didn't get rid of it today. Now, if he got rid of it today when it was valued at $2,000 and he got rid of it at $1,000, then he took a loss for $1,000. But if it was worth $1,000 yesterday and he got rid of it yesterday and today it's worth $2,000, did he truly take a loss? No, he didn't. Because there was no loss there when he sold it. He made the money that it was worth. So there's this empirical understanding out there that there's a give and take, a loss. And why are all these dinar guys selling the dinars? Well, right now, selling the dinar at the price that they make. Now, they're making anywhere between, on a million dinars, they're making a good $200 to $300. Well, it's good business to do that right now. You're a currency exchanger. That's what the business you're in. You're in the business of exchanging currency. And if right now I can make a profit of $300, do you think that Ali or all of these guys, Dinar Safe Dinar and Dinar Bank, and do you think these guys don't have 100 million dinars in holding? You don't think they have 100 million dinars in their own deposits? Sure they do. They've been in the business for 5-6 years selling dinars. They've made millions of dollars. I wouldn't doubt it. As far as I know, what I've spoken to Ali, he has, I think, over a billion dinars.
About 8.5 billion.
Excuse me?
About 8.5 billion.
Yeah, $8.5 billion, something like that. He's got, you know, a tremendous amount. So when it RVs, and if it RVs at $3, the guy's got, you know, $30 billion.
Well,
you know,
the other
thing
is that, Rudy, you're right on the money here, and we could go on and on about this, but it's kind of like the velocity of money. You know, the amount of money available in the world was much smaller in 1970 than it was in 1980 or 1990 or 2000. So it's the velocity of money, that, and money goes around. The more money goes around, the more profit is made. So it's not about printing more money. It's about the value of the money. So
we're in a digital currency world, too.
What's that, Brad?
I said Rudy can explain the digital aspect of this thing as well.
Absolutely. Let's take a couple minutes, Rudy, or 2 or 3 minutes, if you can hit us with the digital currency concept.
Can I get my payment? Oh, okay, thank you. Yeah, go ahead. Oh, what was it?
Oh,
my nurse is going to bring my pain medication. I'm sorry.
Well, you're supposed to be pouring that stuff. It's burgundy. It looks like Zango, but we were talking about. Brad brought up the fact that we have a digital currency, and there's multiple times more digital currency than there is actual hard currency. Correct?
Oh yeah, correct. Yeah, it's eight to ten times more. I'll just let you know, the digital currency, the fractional banking portion, which is really called fractional banking on the digital currency side of it, is way much larger than what's out there printed. So, you know, when they say that there's 27 trillion dinars out there, a portion of it is digital. It's not truly printed currency. You know, who in the right mind is going to print 27 trillion dinars? You know, a lot of it is digital. From what I understood from De La Rue, there was only 26 billion dinars digitally, printed in fiat currency, and the rest of it is in digital fractional banking. So, you know, if you look at the country of Iraq, here we're talking of a huge country, 30 million people. Imagine them paying their accounts off with currency, with paper currency, paying their day-to-day operations with paper currency. It'd be a tremendous, it would take forever to do that. A lot of it is paid through their SDRs, through their digital currency that they have, their fractional banking currency. And then a lot of that's going to be eliminated as we bring in those 000 currency notes. As we bring them in and the bank grabs them, they will destroy the note, but they'll convert it into a digital currency. So it's never really destroyed. The currency in itself, the paper currency, is destroyed, but the money, the value of the money, is just converted into digital.
Rudy, you did a great job. Let me bring up another topic, and that is there's supposedly 18 or 19 currencies that are going to revalue at the time when the RV happens. I thought I read where instead of us backing ours with debt, and many other currencies are going to be backed with the assets of their country. For example, I read, and it could be just smoke where I read this, so don't quote me, where we're going to have a backing of our currency, let's say, at 20% gold, but the rest of it's going to be in the assets in the ground. Same thing with Iraq, it's going to be backed with the assets that they have. Is there any truth to that?
It's like the old saying from the cowboy times, there's gold in them hills. Well, you know, we know that there's gold up there, but it takes a lot to pull it out. So to really back up a currency with its resources and you know, 19 different currencies it's not part of economics 101 when it comes to currencies. It's a part of a currency's value, but it's not the total makeup of the currency. There's been a lot of talk in the currency community that the fiat currency is going to start being backed by gold or by platinum or by silver. A lot of countries want to go back to that standard. The IMF has talked about basketing a lot of currencies, like basketing all the North American currencies, which would be Canada, the United States, Mexico, all of Latin America, basketing into one currency, like the European Union. There's other countries starting to join the European Union, even though it's been through a tremendous year of downfall in their currency value. There's countries that are joining the European Union. They're starting to, you know, conglomerize their currency. Like they say, if you can't beat them, join them. They become much stronger. I think that's where the currency market's headed. But to say that one country can base its total currency value on its resources, it doesn't work like that. I'll tell you what happens. When a country has a lot of resources and the currency is based upon that one resource, when that country starts to increase in its GDP and its consumer index prices start to increase, there's something that happens. Inflation increases also, and it attacks the currency side of it on the international market. So the resource of itself starts to diminish the value of the resource, and the currency starts to be more objective on what it's being, what the consumer index is. So it's very hard to calculate it just on resources. But you know, there's been a lot of talk like that. You know, when it comes to that scope, it's way beyond my understanding. These guys at the IMF and the World Bank, they deal with these world numbers, you know, on a daily basis. But from what I've known for the years of experience, it's a combination of many things. It's a combination of agricultural, manufacturing, resources, GDP, manufacturing indexes, and consumer indexes.
Well, that's very helpful, Rudy. And I wanted to throw something on the table here because I have a lot, some of my friends who I care dearly about who did some investigation on their own without going to the right places have emailed me back or called back and says, I'm going to pass on this because there's a guy that says that we Americans cannot hold currency. And, Brad, you've had this a number of times, and I don't know if you want to – I don't need to mention any names. You can mention who the guy is. But we have a friend who did some investigative reporting who is an ABC reporter, investigative reporter, that we said, would you figure this out for us? And, Brad, this is a very delicate area, but we can hold the currency in our hot little hands and turn it back in.
Yeah, Charlie, I think this is really indicative of everybody's got an agenda, okay?
Yep.
And this particular individual was the first gentleman that was put on the front page of the USA Today 8 or 9 years ago on the Dinar. I happen to have a friend that saw that article and went out and met with him the following day in California and became partners. But now this gentleman and I talked to Ali about this, using a scare tactic where his angle is he has got an organization that will provide you with an Iraqi savings account where you can buy and sell dinars, and this avoids the risk of paper currency, and he tries to couch it where it's illegal to own dinars outside of Iraq, and this just isn't so. And to use a scare tactic, I can't tell you how many questions that you know, we get a knee-jerk reaction. Some guy gets an article out that, and it comes back to us 100 times fold. And so that's why I went right to Ali and debunked that real quick. And besides, then when you try and get your money out of the account, Ali was saying there's a pretty significant fees, upwards of about 20%. So just keep in mind, people that are out there on this dinar roller coaster, going from site to site and listening to people that aren't qualified come up with these imaginations, and it just, it's wild. Everybody's got their own agenda, but the bottom line here, and that's why that dinar 101 is so important. This is real. And you know, when you see Biden and Hillary over in Iraq together a week or so ago, and Biden's been there about 12 times, he's been a real champion for the United States heading this up for our government. And the 5,000 lives we lost in Iraq, and on and on and on, and the fact that our country has significant holdings of dinar. I mean, you think that isn't real? And so when you're out there on this roller coaster, just understand what it's doing to your mind, and that's why I encourage you not to get involved in that and just go on with your life, have patience, and this thing will unfold in due time.
Well, Brad, you're right, and I'd just like to say, I'm not going to give you the guy's name that has, is the, who is perpetrating this, but as you look through the information someone sends it to you, if it happens to be his office is in San Diego, California, and he's saying you can't hold Dinar, the guy is trying through scare tactics to either dissuade you from doing it or investing with him in other things. Like Brad said, this guy's got several hidden agendas, and we got enough information on this guy that he doesn't want to mess with us. And we're just going to tell you,
Charlie,
it ain't true.
Charlie, I told our friend, the reporter, I said, ask him if he's working for so-and-so. And absolutely who it was that Ali told me and the whole story. In fact, Ali originally bought this guy's email list, so he knew the whole thing. And that's why I say the only guy I would trust when this thing comes down is Ali, and he's going to call us personally. So the rest is, it really doesn't make a damn.
Yeah, I just wanted to, yes, hello, Rudy.
Charlie, are you there?
Hello?
Charlie, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, you know, if it was a non-tradable currency and we weren't allowed to hold the currency, and I want everybody to listen to this. You know, Ali's been in this business for about 6 years, and it's been the Iraqi dinar is being traded for about going on 6 years now. We would be breaking international currency laws back and forth. I mean, you know, do you think the CBI would allow all that currency to leave its country if it wasn't allowable? You know, I got to tell you, from all the investors worldwide, and I'm talking about private equity groups, I'm talking about central banks, I'm talking about banks, I'm talking about the retail customers like you and I, we have provided a stable currency for Iraq. If it wasn't for our investment that we've done externally for Iraq, you know, it'd probably be valued at 2,000 or 2,500 right now. We have allowed them to have a more stable currency by investing in their currency. So, you know, whatever this guy's alternative motives are, whatever he's trying to do, you know, to be a currency exchanger here in the United States, you have to have a treasury license, and that is issued by the United States Treasury Department. Do you believe that they would allow Ali to transport millions and millions of dollars worth of dinars if it was an illegal transaction on an international level? Do you think Interpol would?
Yeah, Rudy, you hit the nail on the head there, my friend. A couple quick questions here. Brad and Rudy, are you hearing or seeing in truth that the dinar is disappearing from some of the traders?
Yes. Yes.
I've heard that, and Ali also told me that there was a significant amount that came out last week. So, you know, that temporary supply and demand could have dried up, but I think you'll see the supply and the price stabilize when this new supply starts getting to the traders.
Okay, so Brad, you, at one time you were getting the 10,000 dinar currency notes. Are you still getting those, or are you getting the larger?
That was basically just an imbalance of supply from my source.
Okay.
But everything's back to normal.
Okay, Rudy, why are the IQDs? Why is the dinar showing up in the Forex screens from time to time, where they never were?
I think because there's a lot more speculation. The last month and a half, 2 months, there's been a lot. Well, you know, I got to tell you, since the government was formed, since Iraq's government, democratic government was formed in the last 2 months, there's a lot more speculation in the market. You'll probably find that there's a lot of private investors that are approaching their Forex dealers and asking them, hey, when are you going to start dealing with the Iraqi dinar? And because it's starting to become an open speculation, you know, we've got it's now a forum of discussion not only on the dinar sites but out in the international market. You know, all the banking community, all the financial community knows exactly what's going to happen to Iraq, and they know what it has to take. So when you start getting a lot of speculation from speculators, from I'm talking about big money speculators, the forex market has to start getting themselves involved. So if you start seeing the pairing off, it's because eventually they know that it's going to go to that. It's going to be a transitional international accepted currency, and they're starting to just program their systems. But, you know, you're seeing movements. You're seeing spikes of up and down. Well, that's because there's a lot of auction going on in the speculation market. So that's what you're seeing. You're just seeing all of these new platforms getting ready to introduce the Iraqi dinar.
Yeah, I just got – I won't call this rumor because this is somebody which I've known for years and trust. Her name is Vi. I'll just leave it at that. And the employees at BB&T Bank received memos today stating the bank would no longer be selling dinars. That happens to be in Lexington, Kentucky. And I don't know if it's significant, but I wanted to pass it on to you. Hey, things are happening, guys. And when, like Brad says, when Ali calls, and Brad will get the call, as do some of the other top people that are in Ali's secret circle, so to speak, or the close circle, it's not far away. Would it be fair to say, Brad and Rudy, that maybe if the government would have been seated by Maliki as it should have been and everybody was happy and they had all the ministers were seated, this could have happened a month ago? Is that fair?
Yeah, that's very fair. And another thing I want to kind of put everybody's mind to ease. Just the same way that you bought these dinars, you have the right to sell them. You know, in anything, when you buy something, if I bought a car today and I drove it right off the lot, I'm going to lose $1,000 on the value of that vehicle. True or not?
You're going to lose 20%. Yeah.
You're going to lose 20% just by turning it on and driving it off the lot. So,
right.
You know, when you invest in currency, I want everybody to kind of take a step back and think about this. You bought a tradable currency from a legitimate money exchange facility. If you ever became or ever found yourself tired of sitting on this investment or in the need of your money, you have all the right to go back and sell it to them. You're not losing. You know, you're not losing. Yeah, you might lose $20 or $30 or $40 on your investment, but that's all you're going to lose. You know, it's not like you're holding on to some paper that has no value. That dinar has value. And I when I'm reading on these forums, people are so desperate. Oh, I got into a scam. I bought into a currency that I'm not going to be able to get rid of. No, there's always going to be a buyer for the Iraqi dinar. I promise you that. There's always going to be someone who's going to have a heart of enthusiasm and want to invest in it. So don't feel like you're stuck in an investment. If you really feel that frustrated and that desperate and you need that money back and you need to use it in your life, please, please don't stop yourself. Sell it back. Sell it back, get that money, and provide for those needs that are important to you. But you're not in a losing position. None of you guys are in a losing position. And I think a lot of people tend to forget that. They go by all these rumors. They hear this guy from San Diego. You know, I know what his name is. I'm not going to mention it. There's no need to.
No, we won't do him in yet. We'll let him do himself in.
Do himself in. And I'm sad to say he's from my hometown. But anyway, we know. No, none of you are in a losing investment. You guys can turn around tomorrow and sell your Iraqi dinar if you wanted to. Ali would be more than glad to buy it because he'll have another customer a minute down the line who will buy your dinars from him.
Well, speaking of Ali, when I was out in Southern California last week with our big event with Zango, I drove up with my buddy Scott and somebody else. We stopped at the 100 Wilshire Avenue at the corner of Ocean and Wilshire. If anybody understands what that is maybe the most prime office space in all of Santa Monica. And Santa Monica is really nice, high-end. And so we went and visited the offices. They're there. I'm going to tell you, folks, they're there. I will tell you also, there's no sign there. There's a receptionist that said, Ali's not here right now. They're very, very busy. They're over at the fulfillment center taking care of a lot of orders. You know, I just want you guys to know it's a real place. It's a real address. They have a real office. I just happen to be there because I'm a person who trusts but verify. You've heard me say that before. I told Brad I was going. He said, well, good luck. Go have a fun. And so it's real. And we are in with the number one trader in the world. Brad, you can verify that and solidify that because we're about up with our hour call. We try to keep this right at an hour. And I just want people to know that I was there. And, Rudy, we're going to pray hard for you, my friend. When do you expect you're going to be out of the hospital and head for home?
You know, they were telling me today in the afternoon, my doctors came around and they said that they're just going to monitor me for tonight. And if things look positive tomorrow morning, I should be heading home by tomorrow afternoon.
Well, to help get rid of that inflammation, my friend, grab that burgundy juice and take care of yourself. Drink that Zango
bottle.
Juice.
Yeah, I'm going to down a whole bottle when I get home. I love that stuff, man. I really do. But
you'll never leave home without it. I can tell you that.
I thank you for all your prayers. I thank everybody. Recently, in the last week and a half, I've been, attacked on the internet, about our conference calls, and I've had some pretty vicious emails being sent to me. But, I don't really care what anybody thinks or says. I provide good, legitimate, trustful, rational, intelligent conversation. I bring good information to you guys. I've never once ever pushed any of you guys in the wrong direction. And I think I feel that from everybody that comes onto my Facebook. I feel that from all the emails I get from the BH group, from the Zango Nation. And I truly feel blessed that I'm with a group of people that I find it to be an honor for me to be able to come on board here and try to help and ease everybody and provide information. And so I thank everybody. I'm honored to be your friend. I'm honored that you're my friend. And I'm just very happy to be associated with Brad and with Charlie and with Don.
Well, we greatly appreciate those kind words, my friend. And, folks, I want to put it this way. Brad and I are open targets. We are we own million-dollar businesses. We have friends all over I have friends all over the world with my Zango business, but Brad has them all over. We couldn't afford to risk our reputations if what we didn't believe was and understand to be correct. We don't have control over the government of Iraq. We don't have control over what's going over there, but we understand the leverage of our money just like the leverage of our time in our businesses, and that's what we've learned how to do. And Brad's going to share with a lot of his friends in the BH group some of those dimensions once this thing goes. And Brad, like we all sing together, we wish you'd close your business and start the next one.
Well, Charlie, thanks. And I just want to say, ladies and gentlemen, a big kudos to Rudy and all our best to you, my friend. And I've just got a couple of other announcements before we end the call. Once again, for all of you out there, the BH Group will give you complete assistance to help you purchase your dinars and guide you profitably through the entire process. So just send us an email at brad@thebhgroup.org or give Kelly a call at 419-740-5220. And we thank you for your attention tonight. We'll continue to do our best to educate newbies and the veteran denaritarians so that we can get as many people be blessed before the pending revaluation and give you the most factual, professional intel and updates. Patience is a true virtue, so please understand you are in the right place, you have made the right choice, so let's let the event of a lifetime just run its natural course. It will happen. Charlie, take it away.
Thanks, Brad and Rudy. We'll just close up. We have had several inquiries through the BH Group about Zango and the health products. I'll just leave it this way. When you do contact Kelly at that email, she has sent me some names and phone numbers that I'll follow up in Brad's behalf because, folks, he's swamped with what he's doing. And we know, just like the dinar is as real as our face, we all want to live a healthier life because if you got a lot more money, you want to stay healthy. And we're going to help Rudy stay really healthy because he knows how to make money. So any questions, send them to brad@thebhgroup.org, brad@thebhgroup.org, and we'll help you. Hopefully, hopefully, whether this is maybe another week or two this thing drags on, let's all pray that these guys over in that part of the world get it figured out, and we can move on. And again, folks, put Rudy in your prayer chain. This is like over and out. Rudy, sleep well down there at the hospital in Jacksonville. Get yourself out of there. And Brad, you probably got orders, Phil. I heard your phone ringing in the background, so you got work to do. And I'll talk to you guys tomorrow, and I'll get the call out to everybody ASAP. Thanks, everybody.
Let's keep the people of Iraq in our prayers also.
Absolutely. Keep the people in Iraq, because those people have suffered for 2.5 generations. They deserve to have what we have. They deserve to have freedom like we have, and we're going to help bless them with some. We're going to reinvest in that country, guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
All righty.